Monkey, monkey, delicious.
I went to the zoo looking for you, but what I did find, but what I did find was a couple of elephants, a chimpanzee. That's what I did see, that's what I did see. But something seemed to catch my eye, something seemed to dazzle them off. At Chunky Monkey, yeah, Chunky Monkey, yeah. He looked at me with big blue eyes, and I couldn't help but see a Chunky Monkey.
Would appear. Good afternoon, by the way, Emily. Katherine Boyle. So loud, I don't know what's going on. The studio is in disarray.
Mayhem we got today.
Many reasons. That CD, well, that was a compact disc, right? Mm. And it, let's get technical for a second. It was peaking like flippery.
Mm.
And I've got my knobs down, my gains down, to minus 12. That's as low as you can
he
go.
He was messing
on
with it all the way through that song.
So that's insane. Hey, guys, this could be the first, last, and only time this ever happens on a BBC radio station. Phone op's not turned up. Person who takes the phone calls and here. So
we'll have to do it.
It's going to be called straight to air, guys. 03459 455 555. You phone up, I'll have to whack you straight on air. And I'm trusting you. I'm really trusting you lot not to let us down here today.
Oh, dear.
Like we've been let down by the phone operator. I've got no idea what's going on. Anyway, so phone call straight to air. And that's, I'm groovy with that. The way it works, you phone up, me and Kath will be chatting, and we'll put you straight on the air.
Just join in. Don't wait for an introduction either.
It means it might cost you. I mean, you'll pay then, because we're not phoning you back. I don't know how to phone people back. So I used to do a show in another place, and people still talk of it very fondly, which is very kind of them. Mm. I nicked the idea for Tommy Boyd, of taking calls straight to air. And we used to do it in the drive time show when I'd run out of stuff to say. So we just take calls straight to air because then people would phone up and go, ooh, bums! Which is actually quite a funny call. If someone wants to phone up and go, ooh, bums, then you're more than welcome to 03459 455 555. And then it evolved into a full 3 hours on a Sunday night.
Of
calls straight to air. Mm. And it was wonderful. The freedom. It was me and my producer, Agent Chris, right? Who's now Nick Ferris's producer.
Is he?
It's amazing. His Twitter picture is him stood outside number 10 Downing Street, where I know for a fact he lied about his age when he joined LBC so people would think he was older and more responsible.
Wow.
Yeah, I know. He said he was like 26, and then one day he showed me his driving licence. He was 22.
I've been to LBC. A lot of the production staff are about like 19, aren't
they? I don't know. I haven't been there for a long, long time. Not since the dark period. And by that, I mean... anyway, don't matter.
Yeah.
So it was 3 hours. It was 10 till 1 on a Sunday night, and it was just the perfect time for a phone-in show. 10 till 1. Sweet.
Wouldn't that be great?
I tell you why. It's because the people have sparked up their pipes. Mm-hmm. People have, are settling into their booze. Mm-hmm. And the nut jobs, the nurses have left. So everybody has access to a telephone.
The other thing is the word's not on anymore. So all those people have got to go somewhere, haven't they?
Now, I don't think a three-hour late-night straight-to-air show would work. I don't think it would work now. I think that time has kind of has been and gone. But it was brilliant, and people would phone up, and they would kind of talk, and they would talk nonsense, and sometimes they'd talk to each other, and, you know, sometimes they wouldn't talk to each other, and it was wonderful. And the last one we did, the last show we did, it was a masterpiece, mm-hmm. I would say, because... We had a Japanese band in, this mental Japanese band. There were about 12 of them came in. They didn't speak English.
Right.
I didn't speak Japanese. Their translator, I'll be honest, was rubbish. And one of them was from the Kurikorda Quartet.
Oh, right.
So we phoned up the other three in Tokyo. They did us, and this is beautiful. They played a song live with three of them in Tokyo, one of them in the studio.
Down the phone?
Down the phone with one of them in the studio, adding the bits, and it was joyous. And do you know what? We had a new boss then who was, I'm going to be honest, he was a dick. And he didn't like me. And he wanted to try and get the upper hand with me, right? And so I said, I tell you what, boss, let's scrap Sunday nights. Sorry? Let's finish Sunday nights. He knew that I loved doing the Sunday nights. Mm-hmm. I knew I could never beat that. I also knew he wanted to get rid of Sunday nights.
Right.
Or change it.
So it was your decision. It's like dumped him first.
Yeah. I said, let's get rid of Sunday nights. Sorry? Yeah, I'm done with Triple M. Let's finish. Sorry?
Ooh, bum.
And one more time.
Ooh, bum.
Thank you.
Love you.
He's doing all the greatest hits. So we used to have a bloke that would phone up and go, chalk eyes.
What for?
I don't know.
It doesn't matter, does it?
And that's the beauty of it. It's because, I tell you why, actually, because there are very few places, slightly different now with Twitter and YouTube and things like that, but there are very few places then for people to express themselves artistically or to express their frustrations, you know, at life, at society, at emotion or whatever.
Or just to let rip with something really childish.
Yeah, 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 exactly. Exactly. There was nowhere really you could do that in a public forum. Now there's Twitter.
Yeah.
What else you got? You got SoundCloud. And everyone does everyone did a podcast. That kind of has been and gone a little bit.
Periscope now.
Periscope, yeah. Exactly. So to have a radio show where you could phone up and go, globule, cock eyes, my name is Khan. All of these things, right? We had this bloke who'd phone up, pretend to be an Asian doctor called Dr. Khan.
Right.
And he would spend most of the time telling us how to do handbrake turns in Nissan Micras. Nonsense. Wonderful. People flipping hated it as well. They, you know, it really did get people very, very angry. 03459 455 555 is the phone number if you want to give us a call. Call straight to air. Oh, no, Jen's just turned up. Jen's here. Afternoon, Jen. Who's on line three?
It might be me.
It could be you. Go on, fella.
I'm calling from overseas. I'm calling from Wales. I'm a very regular listener to both this show and the breakfast show, but I just wanted to say I've never said this before. Long-time listener, first-time caller.
Ladies and gentlemen. And that's a phrase. May God bless you. Thank you very much indeed for your call.
Appreciate it. And bonadar to you.
Hey, don't be rude, mate. What? Come on.
What?
Come on for COL. But I don't think, and Jen's here now, so the way it will work is we go back to a normal procedure. You'll phone up, you'll speak to Jen, she'll call you back, so it won't cost you anything. But you can still phone up and do that nonsense. I'm happy with that. If you want to phone up and chat about stuff, happy with that.
Yeah.
Anything, really.
You can sing us a song if you want.
Do whatever you want.
Not poetry.
Oh, flippin' heck.
But if you do it, we won't be able to stop you.
The only poet...
Well, we will.
..I like on the radio... ..Tim Key.
Who he?
He's the sidekick in the Alan Partridge.
Oh, right.
He's a poet.
I think I've heard his
name. And he's brilliant.
Okay.
He's brilliant.
I'd still rather not.
Him and out of respect...
Pamez.
Oh, no. Out of respect, Roger McGough.
OK.
Oh.
Oh, do you know who I really love?
Go on.
I've just thought of him.
Yeah.
That one from Luton.
John Hegley.
Yeah, I love him.
I've been
to see him, actually, like, live.
Live in concert?
Yeah.
John Hegley, live in concert.
He was very good. He did this whole thing about how it's wonderful to wear glasses, and if you don't, then you're a traitor.
It's wonderful to wear glasses, and if you don't, you're a traitor. I should know. I asked my mater. She said, John, you will wear glasses. I said, stick them up people's now.
No.
That's poetry. That's the kind of poetry he does.
Yeah, but he's funnier than that. I mean, a bit. Only a bit.
It's quite funny what I did there. I was freestyling.
Are you wearing ripped jeans?
Yes, mate. Well, I wear ripped jeans all the time because that's all I've got.
I know, but I thought it was by accident. I think you're doing that on purpose.
No, no.
Oh, wow, you've got both knees.
Yeah, these are going to go in the bin. I'm having a good old clear out this week.
I'd like to rip those so they become cut-offs.
All right, Katherine, calm down, love. Let's not get too
steamy. I really would.
I ripped some jeans.
Can I, before we go?
No, don't, because I've not got any clean trousers. I'm having a bit of a nightmare with my washing basket is a full at the moment. It is a full of the clothes. So, no, I did rip some jeans. I actually was wearing some jeans, and I knelt down, and they ripped. And when I got home, I took great delight in going...
It's brilliant. I love that when I get a hole in my tights.
Oh, yeah.
Sometimes I come out of them from the middle outwards.
It's got slutty. Yes, boss!
Ah, you mentioned Agent Chris...
Yes.
I've been trying to discover where he's gone for ages.
He produces Knocker's Fat Ferrari.
Oh, you said Nick Ferris.
Well, yeah. They're the same. They're the same gentleman. He travels by many names. He's not of our kind. He's not of our earth. He works. He walks and works in the shadows and the darkness.
Oh, right,
and he earns.
Yeah,
okay. Get this. Ferris earns about $5,000 a week. $5,000 a week.
Well,
we know where he puts it.
Yeah. Don't we? He invests heavily in Krispy Kremes.
And in his tummy. What's wrong with that? But I was very interested when you spoke earlier about something you nicked from Tommy Boyd.
Yes.
Is Tommy Boyd still on
By the way,
air?
Guys, I think today's show, just because I'm feeling this far, we're not here next week. Is it next week there's a football match?
I don't know.
Anyway.
Probably.
Today's show, I think, is going to be very, very geeky, and I'm also going to play a song that's going to make you cry.
Right, and I think we'll probably get sacked. That's my prediction.
Excellent. Tommy Boyd, I don't know what he's up to.
I think he's doing something now. Yeah, someone sent me a message.
I know he changed his mobile number in his email, so I have no way of... I tried to contact him a while ago. When I got in a little bit of trouble recently, when I was accused of being a racist... I got in touch with Tommy Boyd, and he talked me off the ledge. And
good lad.
But then he's changed his phone number, so I don't know what's going on.
Iain.
Yes.
Iain, when are you going to do another live show?
I'm looking at booking four more in. I'm having a meaty lunch with my agent on Tuesday, and we're looking at booking four in, possibly one in St Albans, one in Milton Keynes, one in Bedford, and one
here's in Hitchin.
We're done, Luton. Excellent. Hitchin.
Hitchin.
We might... Tony, we might do Hitchin. I don't know.
Yes.
We might do. Hello, who's that?
It's Ben in Hitchin.
Ben.
Oh, yeah, we might... I might do one in Hitchin. I'm tempted. Here's the thing, right? And I'm going to say it because it's a good idea, and then I won't do it because I don't want to do it. I'm happy. Yeah. If someone stumps up Dollar, I'm happy to go around and do it in someone's living room.
Are you?
I'd do it in... Here we go. I would do the show in someone's living room for 250 quid.
What's 250 quid.
You'd be careful. They might turn out to be perverts.
In that case, I'd do it for 150. 250 quid. Who is this, by the way?
This Ben. Is Ben in Hitchin.
Ben, 250 quid, and I'll pop round and I'll do it in your living room.
What's the discount for, how many perverts do we need to make it 150?
How many perverts make a piffle? I don't, no perversion. It's strictly, everything below the waist is untouchable. Tops off,
any in Hitchin anyway. There aren't any in Hitchin. You're fine. You'll be fine.
Well, in that case, fingers crossed. What you got for us, Ben?
Most powerful firework you've ever experienced. What is it?
This is the thing. I've only bought fireworks for the first time this year. I've still not set them off.
We didn't bother this year.
It's damp.
It's expensive.
I haven't got a Quality Street tin to put them in.
Well, then that's game over.
Isn't it? You're supposed to put them in a tin.
And have a torch.
Well, hopefully, if it dries up for an hour tonight, we're gonna do it tonight. Oh,
he's chucking it down. Look at it.
Hey, mate. I don't know. Someone sent me... Was it you that sent me a picture of... it looked like an actual 1970s spaceship.
That wasn't you, was it, Ben?
No, it wasn't me, I'm afraid, no.
But I got that too.
I was watching them in Hitchin. They got one at Blue Hearts Hockey Club. Wicked display. Everyone turns out for every year, and it was brilliant. And I had a few beers, and I'm not sure. I sort of started to remember a memory, but I'm not sure if I remembered it or if I just made up. You know when you're a kid and something happens to you and,
What, your uncle touches you or something? Is that it?
No.
Hopefully not that one.
That was last week. No, that was last week.
Okay.
No, that was, you know when...
And that's the bit that got us sacked. Do you remember
it? You misremember something.
Yeah, go on.
And you're like...
Get to the point, Ben!
Anyway, we don't care whether it's true or not. We're going to spread it.
We're going to spread it.
It was a really powerful firework, and my trousers fell down.
I'm going to say that was true.
I was five. I was standing there watching it, and this almighty banger went off, and my trousers fell down.
Wowzers, Ben. That has to be a true story, doesn't it?
It has to be. Surely it is.
Ben, thank you for your call. If your trousers have... it's dangerous, like, close to a phone-in topic. So
have your trousers ever fallen down?
Flipping out. I mean, that is an amazing...
Have yours ever fallen down? I've split them, but I've never... I don't think they've ever come down.
Well, I've frequently walked around with my belt and my flies and my button undone.
I saw the other day.
Yeah, when I went to my to the kid, the eldest's parents' evening, as I stood up, my trousers just did a little wiggle. I thought, what's going on there? And I got out and just touched. Everything was undone. Because
wow.
I'd been driving and it was pushing on my bladder, so I loosened everything. I often sit in my car with the buttons and the flies and the belts and the... Well, what song's that? What song am I going into?
I don't know. It sounds like your defence. When you get rumbled for it.
Buttons and bows. Okay, guys. Well, I would say that's the best start to the show that we've ever had.
Yeah.
I've been talking and I've been watching The Trip, this Steve Coogan, Rob Brydon thing, right? My sister is 10 years ago, the first series. Second series was 6 years ago. Wait, we've kind of finished that now. I was being
That'll
kind of,
do.
That'll do.
That's
that'll
the do. 80s done.
And my sister bought it for me as a Christmas present about 6 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Never watched it. I didn't really like the look of it.
Did she not ask you about it? You told her you enjoyed it or something?
No. I think I might have pulled a face when I opened it. I think I went, oh, I don't like that.
Oh, and she went, oh, well, no, in front of her. That's nice.
Yeah, well, we're honest like that.
And I bought my mum a Shania Twain CD once, and she said she'd been loving it, and then I found it with the wrapper still on.
Oh.
Busted. Oh,
yeah. Shania Twain. Let's just pause for a second and just remember the cover of the CD single of You're Still the One, and it was her coming out of the river. Wowzers. What a lady. What a lady. What a woman. What a girl.
Eileen, of course, is her name.
Who?
Eileen.
What?
That's what her name is.
Eileen Twain.
Not even Twain.
Oh, no. Mm. What's her... What is like Shania Twain's real name?
Eileen Farty Pants or something. I don't know. I'll have a look. Hang on.
Her it's husband...
It's something not her husband anymore. She's free.
She divorced Mutt Lange.
Yeah, I think she did.
Wow.
Let me just check. I may be...
What the hell is going on in the world? 03459 455 555, if you can answer that question.
Right.
Not the name one, but what the hell is going on in the world? But I've been watching The Trip, so I finally took the cellophane off... 3 days ago. Thank you, Jen. I finally took the cellophane off 3 days ago. My sister is possibly listening to this, so thanks very much for that present. It was
morning.
Awesome.
Morning. Afternoon.
Afternoon. Well, no, won't be listening.
It'll be morning. Early morning.
It's midnight there in New
the
Zealand.
The morning. I win.
Hey, so I sent a package to New Zealand, right? And,
It's a bit rude of me. What did you do that for?
No, because...
A nice one.
Sent some comics to that they can't get over there to my niece and nephew. £13 it cost to send, like, about half a dozen comics. I mean, that's taking the pee.
Yeah.
But I said to him, right, I was thinking, well, I wonder if it'll get there before Christmas. Right, send it yesterday.
If you send those kids to Afghanistan, you could send those comics for nothing.
I'm not going to send the kids to Afghanistan.
Well, that's just a thought.
They're not going to be cannon fodder, although. So I thought, I wonder if this will get there before Christmas. So I said to him, how long will this take? He said, oh, they'll have it within a week. Within a week?
No.
Well, there's no future. Brilliant. Within a week.
I used to have pen friends when I was a kid, and it used to take... like weeks for them to get their letters.
And what was the paper like you used to write on?
Really thin. I used to get those
to save money because it was so expensive.
And I used to get the ones that folded up into an envelope.
Yeah, I had them.
Beautiful.
In fact, my pen friend was in New Zealand.
Wow.
I remember he sent me a picture of a boat once. I only wrote about three times.
I had some extraordinary pen friends.
I bet you did. Well, you were a hot young girl.
I wasn't then. I was like flipping Jane Eyre, sitting in the house writing letters to people I'd never met.
Jane Eyre, still, there's some people that still...
Rochester did, didn't he? Anyway, so write to all these people.
Can I just say, that was the highbrow element of the show? Let's go back downstairs.
I used to write to people all over the world, and there was one particular girl in Tanzania.
Yeah.
Who was a friend of a friend, actually.
Yeah.
And we never met, obviously because she used to... I mean, looking back at her letters, they were fairly descriptive of pretty much something that should have been reported that was going on in her school.
What?
She was at a girls' school, boarding school.
And what was going on?
All manner of shenanigans.
With the girls?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah.
My fella sent me a picture of a boat. Short shrift.
Yeah.
It sounds like... Yeah, anyway. 03459 455 555. It was that paper, that wafer thin, the paper, because mm-hmm. it was so expensive. But surely, normal paper in an envelope to abroad, it wouldn't have cost that much
I think
more.
It was a hangover from the olden days. I don't think they sell that paper anymore.
Why is it par avion?
Par avion. Well, because that means by plane.
Yeah,
air
okay.
Mail.
But so why
was the international language, wasn't it, French?
Oh,
so no matter where it went
stuffed.
In the world, someone would understand it. If it was in English and in French.
Get stuffed. French is not the international.
It was. It was the international language of diplomacy.
Was it flippery?
It totally
mate?
Was. You know, there was a long time ago, the royal families of the crown heads of Europe all spoke French to each other because that's what defined you as
a
posh person.
Prince Philip speaks Greek when he's talking to his mum.
No, he doesn't.
From beyond the grave.
No, he doesn't.
I thought it was because...
Oh, here we go.
Well, I think my theory is more correct than yours.
Go on, then.
It's not because it's the international language. It's because the French invented airmail, par avion. Why is that funny?
Did they invent planes, then?
Why is that funny? That is genuinely what I believe to be true.
Mm. They invented that big balloon. They sent a chicken up, didn't they?
No, you're thinking of Jules Verne, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea.
Oh, yes, it is.
I'm sure I heard this story, right, that the French, it was a Frenchman, Le Français de la Garçon, sur la table, who invented it. He had a little plane.
What's he doing on the table?
He was on the table.
Well,
he was on the
it's
table.
Your pronunciation.
Sur.
I thought you said sous.
No, you didn't.
Yeah, I did.
Sous son.
Sisson.
He was the one that invented Emma par avion. My French accent is good, no?
It's beautiful. I'm
Thank
getting
you.
Quite...
I'm sure that's the case. That's why we have that sticker on. Because what other countries, apart from the African ones, Which other countries, apart from Africa, France, and the weird bits of Canada...
Quebec, Montreal.
Which other countries, apart from those ones I've just established, including the whole continent of Africa...
Yeah, quite a lot of Africa, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Which other countries speak French? China?
America.
Oh, get not. They don't. They speak a completely made-up version of English.
And Louisiana speak Creole.
Oh, Louisiana.
Mm-hmm.
Louisiana Purchase. I'm going to say Louisiana was sold from the French to the Americans in Louisiana Purchase. I'm going to say 1776.
Say what you want. I don't know what year it was.
Louisiana.
I can tell you where the word Cajun comes from.
Yeah, go on, sure.
Okay, because
Cajun fighters.
No.
Mixed martial arts.
No.
I'd love to do that, but then have nunchuckers. This is mixed martial arts. Boosh!
Boom!
I'd love to go to a mixed martial arts fight.
Bring a taser.
Yeah.
Arcadian, that's where it comes from.
The game?
Arcadian.
This is getting so geeky. The game?
No, not
like,
the game.
Like Galaxians?
They were sort of colonists, and they wanted to set up this place called Arcadia, and so they called it, that's what they called it, and they spoke Cajun. Arcadian.
I'm going to stop you there, Katherine. Partly because we've got to do travel, partly because that's the dullest thing you've ever said to me. Little twirl at the end. Oh, and that's Ben. Ben, who just called us, has tweeted a picture of himself.
Let's have a look.
Wearing a T-shirt that says, just shut it, pal. Dave Luton, 2015.
Gosh. Ben's lower portion of his face, which is all we can see, looks quite young, doesn't it? Well done, Ben.
And there is Shania Twain climbing out of the water. Oh, dear, her top must have come off.
I've never seen that before.
The CD single. Oh, boy. I splashed out on that.
Oh.
What's Shania Twain's real name?
Eileen Regina Edwards.
Eileen Regina Edwards. Eileen Regina Edwards.
And I'm trying to find a picture of how she used to look before she had her teeth fixed.
It doesn't matter how she looked then. When I met her, she was hot. That's right. I met her. I interviewed Shania Twain and we pretended to kiss for a little skit. fun times. Hey, listen, can I play you...
Is this the one that's going to make me cry?
No, that's coming up. Have you heard of a guy called Fionn Regan?
No.
He's the one that's going to make you cry.
He's got a girl's name.
Yeah, I know, he's brilliant. I met him years ago, right? And it popped up. I'm so glad I've updated my music on my iPod because he popped up on iPod. I'll play it a bit. He's brilliant.
Right, all right.
But then earlier on we played Chunky Monkey. That's because that popped up on my iPod and it reminded me of this. Now,
yeah,
I'm going to play you a song. I think I'm the only person that remembers this song. It was a minor hit in about 1992.
Yeah.
I bought the album for cut price, right? The woman can't sing. The lyrics are awful. And then when I played this in the car today, I thought, I used to love this song.
Mm-hmm.
And it stands the test. It's got the brilliant line, if you want to get off, that's what we'll do.
Wow.
Yeah, I know. No one else is going to like this song. You'll like this song. You've got taste in music, even though it sounds awful.
Right.
She can't sing.
I can see beyond that.
The lyrics are terrible. This is a pop classic.
What we'll do, and if you want. city to me.
See what you mean?
Isn't it great though?
Yeah.
I think
she's making herself a bit too available, but apart from that, yes.
If you want to get off, yeah, that's what we'll do. Fine. Yeah. I used to love that song. The Poppies. They're the Poppies.
Really? Right.
It's a good name for a band.
And it is poppy.
Very poppy. And the whole album is kind of, the album isn't quite as strong as that, but it's a treat, and I used to love it. And every now and then, every 5 years or so, I go, oh, the Poppies. I wonder if. Oh, and it makes me. It reminds me of my second year in college. Particularly, we were in a flat, the three of us. Me, Steve and Darren, and Darren later turned out to be gay, and that's absolutely fine, although it was a shock at the time. Poor.
Was it because of Steve?
No, well...
Steve had Adam, obviously.
Steve was a good-looking guy. Poor Julie. Julia, is all I'll say. Anyway, we had to rotate rooms, OK?
You had to?
Well, yeah. And in the second term, I had the box room, mm-hmm. and a mysterious puddle developed in the floor. It was an actual puddle. You could see a puddle in the floor. And it came, and it was there for about 2 months, and then it went again. And there was never...
Never an explanation.
Never an hex... Hello?
Hello?
Hello, who's that?
It's Dr. Watts.
Hello, aww. Dr. Watts. There was never...
I want to share something with you guys. It was quite important for me last night.
Go on.
Oh, hang on.
Right, OK. No, don't worry, Katherine. It's all right. Don't worry. It's OK, my dear. Listen, 2 years ago, I got hit by a car, and I nearly lost my left leg, right?
Yeah.
And, my left leg looks like something that should be on a kebab skewer or in one of those dodgy vans in the council estate.
I hope you've got photographs of it.
Oh, mate, I have, believe me. But listen, last night I started going swimming again to try and, you know, get a bit of flab off and get my hip moving again because that was smashed up as well.
Yeah.
And I've been wearing those
You're being very brave about it.
Well, I've been wearing those triathlon trousers because I basically hate the way the leg looks, you see.
All right.
But triathlon
trousers. Yeah, like a legging.
Yeah, like leggings, you know.
Is it leggings?
No, leggings.
I think it's leggings.
What, because you put your legs in?
Yeah.
They could be legs-ins.
OK, well, where does the... Hang on a second, we will come back to this, Dr. Watts. Where does the name come from, then?
Well, because of legs.
Ah-ha! OK, so it will be legs-ins. Leggings. It will be leggings.
It probably did start as legs-ins, but that didn't work out.
Yeah, so it's leggings. It is leggings, not leggings. Mm. Here's the thing... You've got another think coming.
No.
Yes.
No.
Oh, yes. Yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
And it's a real mind field.
No.
Yes.
No.
Bibs and bobs.
Stop it.
These are all...
All triggers for violence from me.
None of you speak English correctly. It's a real mind field when you talk about bibs and bobs and whatever the other one was.
Minefield. It's a minefield.
No, it's a minefield. You've got another thing coming, young lady.
Stop it.
I mean, and that's
I've got something else to come.
Sorry?
I've got something else to come.
Please, interject.
Yes.
This is the important bit for me, anyway. Last night I went swimming in shorts... With everything on show.
Boom!
Very empowering.
I'm sure it was. I feel, though, as a responsible adult, I should be body shaming this guy.
No.
I don't want to see that.
Tough.
I don't want to see a kebab going for a swim.
This is what you've got to think, and everyone should think this when they go swimming. Get it out. Someone's worse off than you. Someone's better off
than everything
you.
Out.
All right, don't get that out.
Here's the thing. No, well done, Dr. Watson. I know it's, I'm teasing. Well done. Here's the thing, right? Was there a fat old man in his 70s wearing budgie smugglers? Because there always is at my swimming pool. It's not even the same bloke. There's
standard
a
issue.
Fat old man, like fat, wearing the tiniest little Speedos, big white hairy chest, and they just think, oh, for crying out. It goes right up his back. It's horrible, Watts.
Do you know what? In the summer, I frequent this pub at lunch break from work.
Don't tell me there's one in there.
No, it's by the canal in Fenny Stratford, and this old boy was on this, obviously, a canal boat, gets off his boat, the smallest budget smugglers you've ever seen, and this beautiful pert belly and a tiny little pigeon chest covered in white hair. It was the most horrific thing I've ever seen.
Old men disgust me. When will they all die out?
One day I'll fancy an old man. That's what's going to happen.
You fancy Michael Palin?
Oh, no, I don't.
I'm trying to fix you up, Katherine.
No, I don't fancy Michael Palin as he is now.
Dr. Watts, congratulations. Well done, mate. That's good news. 03459 455 555. You phone up, you speak to Jen, she phones you back, and then you're kind of on air. You hear her speaking on the phone, you're probably on air.
Yeah.
Huh?
I'm still trying to find a picture of someone. I'm not making this up. Is this another memory from my childhood?
You're going
that
close to a phone in?
Well, look. What? Shania Twain used to have wonky teeth and bad hair, didn't she?
No.
Yeah, she did.
She's always been the most beautiful woman in country.
No.
So, anyway, I've been watching The Trip, OK? The
right.
First series. I want to get the second series, but it's £4.40 plus £1.26 postage on Amazon. I'm not that bothered.
Mm-hmm.
And I really enjoyed it. I did it all in 3 days, OK?
Yeah.
I had to keep stopping it because the boys would come in. And there's the bit
they do swear a bit, don't they?
The bit that made me laugh out loud, right, is Coogan's really insecure in it. And he's having a thing. It turns out it's a dream. But he's walking down and this bloke comes out of a news agent and goes, aha! Does he go, all right, pal. He goes, all right, Steve Coogan, you sign this for me. And he goes, Steve, is it true what everyone says about you? He says, what's that? That you're a massive crumb.
Oh.
Right? And he goes, well, I don't know. Whoever said that obviously doesn't know me at all. And the bloke opens the front page of the newspaper and it says, Steve Coogan is a massive crumb, says his dad.
Oh, wow.
And it's really good. I really enjoyed it. But it's left me feeling spiritually bereft, mm-hmm. right? It's made me question. I think Steve Coogan is brilliant. I've just bought a Steve Coogan box set. I think he's a genius.
You admire his talent.
I don't think he's a very nice man. And having met
Does
him,
it matter?
But this is... You know, you've kind of put part of the problem into a question for me. Thank you. Having met him years ago, when he was bang on it, he wasn't very polite to me. He's very rude to me, in fact. So I've always kind of held that grudge. But watching this programme, I kind of think, actually, I don't think he is a very nice man. Rob Brydon, who's always been delightful to me, the few times I've worked with him, again, you come across and you think, oh, I don't know if...
But is that because you don't like the other one? So you think if they get on, then he must be...
Part of it is jealousy. Right, because yeah. they're a little bit older than
Same
me.
Same reason I don't like Lauren Laverne, it's not her fault.
Yeah. Part of it is jealousy. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a slight jealousy. I mean, they're both a little bit older than... Well, probably Coogan's probably maybe about 10 years older than me now.
Yeah.
And Brydon's probably about 10 years older than me, actually. So I've got 10 years to catch up.
Steve Coogan's still a very sexy man, though, isn't he?
He's very sexy. I see Brydon, though, as kind of being part of that Radio 4 set that I feel I should be a part of.
Yeah. Okay, there it is.
Do you know what I mean?
There it is.
That I should be doing those panels. I'm terrible on panel shows. Oh, I've just reminded us.
Exactly. You don't want to do them, but you watch people doing them and think, I could be better than that.
But Hello, who's that?
Graham.
Hello, Graham, what you got?
You know, you were going about Yvette Fielding the other day and you don't believe it all and all that.
Yeah.
I don't believe ghosts. No, it's rubbish.
Yeah, yesterday, so freaky. I do a drop in MLM's did and there's a car there with a car sticker on the back of it with a date. I think, obviously, someone passed away. And the date was something 2009, and yesterday's date, which was the sixth of November 2011. Mm-hmm. And already, I don't read this thing. It's always in the way where I've got to do my delivery. And for the first time yesterday, I read the date, and I'm thinking, oh, it's the day someone must have died. And 2 minutes later, this woman comes around and says, can you move the lorry? I need to get my car out. And it was her car. And I said, oh, I'm very sorry, but you're lost. And she was like, oh, thank you very much. And I thought to myself, is it her? I think the name is Billy Dove.
And I know that name.
I thought, was it him saying hello? which was really, really freaking.
Now, we know that we've talked about Billy Dove on this show. Catherine, give us a slight recap as to who Billy Dove was.
He was a young lad who went out on a night out and ended up being stabbed, and he died. And he had nothing to do with it.
They set up a cracking charity, and he was into football. And Justin,
now his parents go around schools talking about knife crime.
But so they're an amazing family, and they've popped up on the show from time to time. I know Justin is kind of, I don't know, friends with them, but has contacts with them. But so hang on, what do you think, what do you mean... You thought it was him saying hello?
His relative.
What bit did you interpret? I missed a bit. Sorry, Greg. Which bit was him saying hello to his relatives, do you think?
Because I said, I'm sorry for your loss. Oh, thank you very much.
Because it was the anniversary?
Yeah. I never read it, ever.
Yeah. Isn't that funny?
I read it yesterday.
Or it could be a coincidence. Could just be a coincidence.
Yeah, maybe it was a coincidence, but... I thought maybe he was just saying hello. I don't believe in all that myself, to be honest. But it was just really, really coincidence.
But the thing about coincidences, right? They're amazing. They're coincidences, and that's the beauty of them. Because
But apparently, scientifically, it'd be weirder if they never happened.
Well, here's the thing. If you have... I don't know what the stats are, Grace. I'm gonna make them up slightly, but the premise holds true. If you have 15 people in a room, the odds are that two of them will share the same birth. There's more chance of two of them sharing the same birthday than of none of them sharing the same birthday.
Here's a coincidence.
Yeah.
100% the statistics are made up on the spot.
Yeah, absolutely. Here's a coincidence. When I was studying abroad, I use the word studying loosely.
We know what you were studying.
I was talking to this girl who was...
French sausage.
She was in... No, not French.
Le sausage.
No.
Le Spanish, the Spanish chorizo.
Anyway, your dad might be listening to this.
He's not. He's put on Abbey Road by the Beatles.
Anyway, stop it. Oh, so right. So I'm at this party and I meet a girl who's also an English student. Oh. Right, we get chatting. She's from a university elsewhere in the country, miles away from where I was from. She's elsewhere in the country, miles away from where I'm from. She told me a story about me.
What?
Yes. A friend of a friend. It was one of those stories, and it was a story about me.
We've all heard that story.
Thank you very much indeed.
Yeah.
Oh, 03459455555.
So found the out thing that about, she was at college with a friend of mine from school.
The thing about the birthdays is true.
Mm. Okay.
No, but don't you think it's amazing? There are 15 people. It's not 15. It's something like that. Maybe so, it's...
No, because that can't work, because that means everyone... That's clearly balls.
No.
It is, though. It's, you've got 15 people. Someone's got to be left out of this whole...
Well, the first show started with a maths problem. The last show is starting with a maths problem. No, if there's 15 people in a room together, there's more chance of two of them having the same birthday than not.
Oh, two of them. All right, fair enough. I thought you meant all of them.
Not all of them, you complete and utter cheese. Well, that's not going to happen.
I was going to say.
If it did, that would be a real coinkydonk.
But that would be very spooky, and we should phone Yvette Fielding and offer her an official apology.
Oh, 3459 455 555. So, you know what job I got offered yesterday.
You should take it.
Well, it would mean January. It would mean I couldn't work here January to March.
You should take it.
Mate, I would be spending 6 weeks. I think it's being filmed in the Alps.
What? No, it's not. Well, they'll take you down the snow dome.
No. It's filmed abroad. So I've been offered. I don't know why you're laughing, because I could do it.
Because I know the outfits they wear.
I could totally do it. I've been offered. I'm just going to check the lyrics of Gigantic by the Pixies to make sure it's clean. I have been offered to be a contestant, a contender, one of the stars, one of the celebrities on Channel 4's hit ski jump show, The Jump. Now, I don't know why that makes you laugh so much.
Have you ever seen it? It's also cack.
Well, I know it's cack. I mean, listen...
But it's probably well paid, so get in there.
It's not that well paid. Oh. I said to my agent, no...
And you could break yourself.
I said to my agent, I'm going to say no... But before I put a full stop after that, no, am I walking away? Am I walking away for a significant amount of money? He said, well, for the 6 weeks' work, and it will be about 20 grand. Now, not inconsiderable. In TV terms, though, for 6 weeks, that's poor.
And you're risking life and literally limb.
So I said, if it was £40,000 or £50,000, I would do it. So if they were to up their offer to, well...
So this is live negotiation.
I've said it on air now. So I've had to go. If they... I would do... How much would you do the jump for, then?
20 grand. 20 grand. But then I'm not... You know, they're never going to ask me to do that. That's a lot of money to me.
Well, it's a lot of money to me.
What is essentially, like, messing about?
Well, it's... You're basically skiing with Anthea Turner, basically. I mean, that's the calibre. I don't know anyone else. They've asked Paul Kay to be on it.
Oh, right.
Dennis Pennis.
Yeah.
Nice lad. I like Paul. Yeah. I've worked with Paul in the past. He's a nice lad. Works very closely with a friend of mine, another Paul.
The Pauls.
If you want to see the what Paul Garner and Paul Kay have created, then YouTube Strutter. I think that's his name. Strutter. Not safe for work, guys. Not safe for work.
But very, no one's at work today, apart from the unlucky ones.
Very, very potty-mouthed. I wonder... I think this is clean. I think we can get away with this. Let's have a go at this.
This I know, his teeth as white as snow. What a gas it was to see him walk her every day into a shady place. With her lips she said, hey, power, 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 it's out of ball. Hey, power, 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 it's out of ball. Hey, power, 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 it's out of ball. Walk her every day into a shady place. He's not the dark, but I want her. Hey, power, 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 let's have a ball. Hey, power, 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 let's have a ball. Hey, power, 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 let's have a ball.
It's just ski jump. I mean, I've never been skiing.
Right.
I would snap.
I have. And they hurt. Those boots hurt.
Don't worry about the boots
hurting.
No, the
best part of skiing, I liked the skiing bit, being rescued by Frenchmen, but I kept falling off piste.
Let me do the punchline. Well, don't go skiing when you're drunk, then.
Oh.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
And that joke was brought to you by 1972. But the best part of it, apart from the skiing bit, was taking my boots off at the end. Because they're really flipping hurt.
Well, you can do that at home. You can put tight shoes on at home.
No, they're not tight. It's a whole different kind of pain. It's like you're wearing sort of
boots.
Almost like a metal...
Ski boots.
Plastic boots. Yeah, they don't give at all.
You said they metal or plastic. Make your mind up.
Well, it feels like metal by the end.
You're flitting back and forth between substances.
It's very hard.
Which is a sign of addiction. First sign of addiction.
Anyway, I found that picture of Shania Twain. Anyway.
You've spent the last 50 minutes of the show looking for a ropey Shania Twain.
She's still cute.
Those teeth aren't real.
They are.
Those teeth aren't real. That's the lady from The X Factor with the teeth.
No, that's her. That's Eileen.
So would
Regina,
you,
Regina Edwards?
I've made the right decision turning down the slope.
I can't tell you that. I can't tell you that. You've got.
Should we go through the list of what I've turned down in the past? Well, I walked away from the last series of the 11 o'clock show a week before it was about to start. Mm-hmm. 10 week gig.
Right.
$9,000 a week. You flipping idiot. All you right. Flipping, you bloody idiot!
That was around the same time I turned down the chance to be in the Spice Girls cover band Nice and Spicy.
OK, so we quit.
I don't think that paid.
I've turned down I'm a Celeb 3 times.
Right.
Big Brother twice. Mm. The Jump. I turned down Come Dine With Me about a dozen times before I finally went, oh, God, I'll do it then. Wish I'd said no to that. It was hellish. Mm. What else have I've turned down... I turned down something the other day, actually. I got asked for another one the other day. Name some programmes. I turned down Have I Got News For You, hosting that.
Really?
Doing. I've not told you that. I was asked to host Have I Got News For You. I went, nah, I'm all right.
Was that in the dark? Was that post-Dayton?
It was post-Dayton. Mm-hmm. It was dark days for everybody. Yep, when everyone has Have a Go. And I was presenting Rise at the time, breakfast TV show, so I had to be up at 3:30, and I went, nah, I'll be too tired. And inside I'm going, I don't want to do it. I'll be scared. I'll get found out.
Don't blame
you. What an idiot. Of course I should have done it, though. Of course I should have done it. Stupid.
You didn't have a mate that said you'd do it anyway.
I needed an agent that said, Iain, I'm not going to let you say no to this one. Yeah. You're doing it. That's what I needed. But yeah. Melanie didn't. And that's fine. And that's my problem. 03459455.
Blame Melanie.
No, she was good, actually. She was brilliant. 03459455555 is the telephone number. If you want to give
just
us a call.
Just ring us up.
Anything you want to... Oh! So the trips, I'm going to lend it to you. I'd like you to watch it.
Right.
But it's really left me... And this is not a word I use very often because I think it's a pretentious word. But it actually... Don't take the mick out of my body language.
I'm not!
This is me being sincere and thoughtful. I'm trying to present a new...
Hidden Palms.
I'm trying to... a great show. I'm thinking of Wild Palms, which wasn't such a great show. Remember Wild Palms?
Was that about trees?
No, it was the bloke from Taking Care of Business, a.k.a. Filofax... James Belushi.
Oh, right.
He was in it. And I think it was it was Lynch, David Lynch. And it was like a spin-off of Laura Palmer.
Oh, right, Twin Peaks.
That's the fella. Twin Peaks, by the way, you can now get...
That book was filthy. We passed that round.
You couldn't get the second series of Twin Peaks for years because there was a copyright issue. Mm-hmm. I managed to get a hooky version. You find out about 6 episodes before the end who the murderer is.
Yeah, spoils it.
I didn't watch the rest of it. They're bringing Twin Peaks back. They're making Twin Peaks again. David Lynch is doing it.
You know we were talking about films that's frightened you?
No.
Yeah, the other day. Oh, you said you found it hard.
Because Scott was terrified of the Papa Dog. Don't mention it. Oh, please don't mention the Papa Dog.
Don't mention it. You've brought it all back to him now.
I'm so scared of the Papa Dog.
Somewhere in London, there's a man quivering behind a counter of a T-shirt shop.
All of his T-shirts are a little bit wonk. Who's that?
Sorry, that was funny. It's Joe from London.
Hello, Joe. Oh, there's a bloke in Uxbridge,
London,
right?
London Joe.
He's making T-shirts, right? And they're good T-shirts, but they're all a little bit wonky now because his hands are shaking. Yeah, he can't get a steady hand because of the Babadook. The Babadook has ruined the T-shirt business in Uxbridge.
Yeah.
It's a shame that.
It can happen.
Joe, what you got for us?
I was just washing some beer off some pita bread and I thought Iain will like that.
washing some beer off of some pita bread.
What happened? Did you not pack your bag properly?
No, I had a friend round last night who brought 2 beers, put them in the freezer. We both forgot about them where we were watching that Narco show, got completely enraptured in that. And then I've just gone to get some pita bread out of my freezer, and of course these beers have exploded. And I thought, I'll give that a rinse off and I'll ring Iain.
It'd be fine.
Well, if anything, because, I mean, I don't drink anymore, but you can add booze to all kinds of foods, can't you, to improve the taste?
Booze bread.
Booze cheese.
Booze pudding.
Booze pie.
Booze steaks.
Booze baby.
Topics, Iain, I wanted to run by you.
Go on then, fella.
And you can choose, because I think whenever I get you on a subject that you really like, it's always hilarious. But I thought I'd give you... I bought three, I'm prepared.
Okay, go.
First,
yes.
90s Canadian crime TV series, Due South.
Oh, yeah, starring Jack D lookalike.
Paul Gross.
He looks exactly like Jack D. Who played his dad?
I couldn't tell you.
Katherine, who played his dad?
Was it Frasier's dad?
Leslie Nielsen.
Oh,
Leslie Nielsen, the famous canoe.
That wasn't his dad, actually. That was his dad's colleague.
Are you sure, Joseph?
Anyway, are we talking about old TV programmes?
I found myself watching a documentary on it on a school night about 3 a.m. I couldn't sleep the other night.
A documentary about Due South?
Yes.
Where did you find that?
They couldn't get... It's on YouTube. They couldn't get Paul Haggis because he was too busy writing Quantum of Solace, I think, which was rubbish, by the way. So it's that.
Yeah.
Or you can have 1996 album masterpiece by the Fugees called The Score.
Oh, I loved that. The Fugees. No, I flipping loved that.
Right, be quick, because we've got to go. I know we try and be free for me, but I've got...
On Tuesday's show, you said, Kathy, your eye's gone funny. I've never seen it do that. And you went, it's gone walkabout. And she went, yeah, it's gone to the shops. I can't stop thinking about it.
Yeah, one eye's gone to the shops, the other one's coming back with the change.
Yeah, nice.
That's what was happening.
Thanks very much indeed. 03459 455 555. Thank you very much indeed. So this is how it works. You call up 03459 455 555. You speak to Jen. She calls you back. You come on the air. There's no topics. There's no script. There's nothing. It's just, you know, playing songs and chatting. You up for it? Excellent stuff.
To say what's good to you, observe the blood, the rose tattoo of the fingerprints on me from you. Other evidence has shown that you and I are still alone. We skirt around the danger zone and don't talk about it. My man who watches from the wall, her mocking smile says it all. She records the rise and fall of every soldier passing. But the only soldier now is me. I'm fighting things I cannot see. I think it's called my destiny. I am changing, Marlena on the wall. Well, I walk to your house in the afternoon by the butcher shop with a sawdust room. Don't give away the goods too soon is what you might have told me. And I tried so hard to resist when you held me in your handsome fist and reminded me of the night we kissed and of why I should be leaving. Marlena watches from the wall. Her mocking smile says it all. She records the rise and fall of every soldier passing. But the only soldier now is me. I'm fighting things I cannot see. I think it's called my destiny that I am changing. Marlena on the wall. Blood, the rose tattoo of the fingerprints on me from you. Other evidence has shown that you and I are still alone. We skirt around the danger zone and don't talk about it later. And I tried so hard to resist when you held me in your handsome fist and reminded me of the night we kissed and of why I should be leaving. My man who watches from the wall, a mocking smile says it all. She recorded the rise and fall of every man who's been here. The only one here now is me. I'm fighting things I cannot see. I think it's called my destiny that I am changing, 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 changing. Marlena watches from the wall. Her mocking smile says it all. She records the rise and fall of every soldier passing. But the only soldier now is me. I'm fighting things I cannot see. I think it's called my destiny that I am changing.
Could never work out, Vega. She did that...
I like her.
You talk about songs. No, that's singing a song. I specifically said... We were talking in the week about songs that where they're the good old upbeat, up-tempo songs, and you listen to the lyrics 3 years later...
Oh, Luca.
Well, yeah, Lucas. Oh, it's my dark. Name is Luca. I live on the second floor. Yeah. Oh, child abuse.
If you hear something late at night, some kind of tussle, some kind of fight.
Child abuse.
Yeah, it's
whereas
awful.
At least, I hate Tracy Chapman, but at least she was honest. Her songs
sounded
miserable because, and they were miserable. They were about being beaten up and stuff like that. And she let you know that by her dour tunage and her miserable, miserable instrumentation.
But what a musician.
No. People we've forgotten about. We're going to play people we've forgotten about tennis. I go first. Tracy Chapman.
Tanita Tikaram.
That
was a good one.
That was a good one. You did her brother was an actor, wasn't he?
He still is. Ramon Tikaram.
Okay, I'm trying to think of her name. The big afro. Loved a little... I had the album and it was only one good song on it.
Joan Armour Trading?
No, not Joan Armour Trading, for crying out loud.
Who then?
I want to say Mimi. But...
Oh, I know you mean. I know you mean. Because I hang out with my mum too much. You mean...
Sounds like Marge Simpson. You know exactly who I mean.
What's her name?
Mimi someone. Mimi
no,
Chantel.
Maisie.
Macy Gray. Okay, so Macy Gray.
We've been married too long, mate.
I know, flipping heck. I like that song. I love that song. I think that song is brilliant, but the album is a stinker. She was doing a gig recently.
She was a bit hit and miss, wasn't she, because of obvious reasons.
She was a massive pothead.
Yeah.
I think we can say without fear. Someone was telling me, I worked in Birmingham on a show, and one of the techies there was saying that she did a show, came out late, 40 minutes late, saw there wasn't much audience, went backstage and, let's just say, relaxed herself a bit more and then came out and gave a very shoddy performance. Go on, your turn.
But that became the act, didn't it?
Yeah. That's a great song, though.
All right. What about... Taylor Dane.
Oh, she was rough.
Yeah.
What was her song?
But, like, out... She was... what did she sing? Taylor Dane. Something where she was, like...
Dirty.
Yeah, filthy.
All right, Zoe.
Oh, yeah. Sunshine on a Rainy Day.
My dad had that on Kasingle.
I love that song.
Kasingle!
That reminds me of working at Woburn Safari Park during the summer of my A-levels.
Yeah.
And I had to read, like, 11 books. Mm. And I thought, I'm never going to do it. Working at Woburn Safari Park, I did. They put me in the ice cream stall, like, in the middle of nowhere, and forgot about me. No one ever came. No one bought anything. I read 11 books.
Wowzers, and that's why you're so clever and boring. Yeah. Go on, your turn.
All right, I'm just trying to think what Taylor Dane done sing.
Well, here's one, and he mentioned them earlier on.
Oh.
Go on.
Jewel.
Gem.
Oh, yeah, do you remember Gem?
Yeah, I've got Gem. I like Gem.
Olive.
Oh, I love Olive. I love Olive so much, that album.
I got her song on, like, this, like, 3-CD set that came in a tin from Nescafe.
Sorry.
That was quite good.
And you know what? You're Not Alone was the hit. That wasn't the song, though. This. Two faces. See how quickly I got there?
Yeah.
This is the song. The drums ruin it a bit. Was Olive the woman, or was she the group? Because it was like a man, wasn't it? With the producer.
Mm.
Here's one. All right, here's one.
Go on. Hang on.
The chorus, this is sublime.
This is my youth you're playing.
This is me coming back from Pakistan and thinking, right, I've discovered a new world. I'm a man. Hello?
Hello, yes. I've got one name for you.
Go on.
Martika.
Thank you very much.
Come and get some. Couldn't you have told me before? I would have loved
you so much. Martika's Kitchen. Here's one. Is it just women we're doing or men?
Both.
I'll give you Ronnie Size. Ronnie Size represents. I spent a very, let's say, bubbly New Year watching Ronnie Size at Alexandra Palace. Bubbly.
Right, there's one coming.
Yep.
Who was the one that sang? Oh, Finlay Quay.
I saw Finlay Quay in Belsize Park once.
In concert or just saw him?
Just walking there. He was coming out of a newsagent, so I went, all right, Finn. Fine. If you want to play that game, I bat Finlay Quay back at you and I'm going to send it back with Eagle Eye Cherry.
Save tonight. Remember that?
Oh, I don't know why Eagle Eye Cherry, the EEC, has made me laugh so much.
Well, EEC, I'll give you Baby D.
Oh! Hey, I was listening. One of my favourite shows on Radio 4 is the Dead People Show. I can't remember what it's called. In Memoriam. They died
last
this
word.
Week. Last Word. Is it? It's not Paris that presents it. Who is it? It's a guy I like the sound of. I like the sound of Paris until you read his politics. Anyway, and they had a woman on there yesterday. It's really good programme. I love it. I love that programme. Because they have such an interesting mix of people. And they had this Colin Welland. He was in Kez.
Okay.
You'd recognise him. Bubble cut, big moustache. He died. They had a woman who had sold millions... He said, and also coming up on the show tonight, it's a woman whose name escapes me, who rose to fame with the...
He said his name, she died and he couldn't even give her respect to know her name.
He knew the name. Oh. And I'm laughing, not because she died. It sounds like a really tragic story and it's made me want to read more about her. Not necessarily investigate her music. It's not my cup of tea. But you don't very often hear this band's name on Radio 4. The Urban Cookie Collective.
Oh, yeah.
It was the singer from the Urban Cookie Collective had died, right? And, I mean, not a massive band, but she'd also sung... She'd toured with Moby, right?
Right.
And I know, the music thief. She'd toured with Moby, right, for years,
To like Moby, but...
So she'd had an amazing career. Do you know what she ended up doing? Security in South London. She was a security guard in South London. Isn't that heartbreaking? Yeah. Hey, speaking of heartbreaking, I'm going to play a song.
Oh, no.
I'm going to play a Lemonhead song in a minute that's a cover of a Kiss song about... It's called Plastercaster. Do you know the story of the Plastercasters?
No.
Oh, you don't know the story of the Plastercasters?
No.
These groupies. The Plastercasters. It was Pamela Desbarres and a couple of others.
Ah, now.
Yes.
Justin and Kelly and I were talking about... Is there something to do with an aeroplane? Did they do it on planes?
No, well, they did it anywhere, planes and hotel rooms.
Right.
They would
pop
take,
stars, they'd take casts of their...
They would take plaster casts. Betty Boo, thank you. Yeah, we'll take
oh,
that.
Oh, I love Betty Boo.
Betty Boo. Just
I know
doing,
the rap.
Oh, please. Hang on a second. I think we have an effect for that. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Betty Boo rap.
No, I'm not doing it. Well, it's me again, and how did you guess? Because last time you were really... I'm not doing it.
Okay. That's disappointing. They would take plaster casts of pop stars, excited. They would take excited. Hang on a minute, I can make this work so that some people will get it and some won't. They would take plaster casts of excited members of pop groups.
Right.
Every base is covered there.
Well, it would be.
So we're going to. In fact, let me play that song. I'm getting all over the place. I'm going to play the Lemonheads version. So Kiss wrote a song. About it's filthy, but it's such a high frequency that no one will hear it. So here's the Lemonheads singing Plastercaster.
This one's going to make you cry.
Well, it might do, but this might make you cry. This is a cracking tune. Here we go. Have some of this. 03459 455 555.
Wait.
There we go. I don't know. The Lemonheads are going off on a tangent there. I don't know their version as well as the Kiss version, so probably best to... they're probably best. Thank you very much indeed, ladies and gentlemen.
He's finished.
In many ways, he is indeed finished.
Mm. So anyway, this word that you didn't want to use because you thought it would sound...
The trip discombobulated me.
Wow.
It's made me feel unsettled within the universe and within my own skin.
Well, let's explore that.
Well, I don't know how to. I mean, it's made me question my relationship with Coogan and Bride, and it's made me question my relationship with television comedy, and also with just myself. It's weird. I laughed a lot, but it left me feeling very, very empty. Very empty and dissatisfied.
Is it because it was just an improv thing and so there was no obvious structure to it, so you're never going to feel like it's done?
No. It's like this. It's the same as this show. It's just them talking, you know, basically. And there's kind of an element of snarkiness. I don't know. I think I'm about to reevaluate my relationship with Steve Coogan after reading the poor autobiography, watching the trip, and now I've got a 14-disc Coogan box set.
You know, you may be a different person now from who he was when he was mean to you that day.
Oh, I mean, surely.
That was very Partridge.
No, but surely he is. It was, I mean, that was, I guess, 19...
And you don't know what was going on in his day.
That was like 1999, or maybe the one after. I don't, you know, it was around about there. I mean, it was off his nut when I had him on live. It was such a frustrating live TV experience. Mm. I was stitched up, right? I was completely stitched up, and I was the whipping boy for what was basically one of the worst television programmes of all time.
Right.
I had to interview Richard Herring, who at the time hated me. I don't know what Mr. Herring's feelings are on me now, but I know that he'd recently slagged me off a TV show. I love Richard Herring, by the way. I think Herring and Lee are brilliant. But it was also awkward because he'd also been very, very rude about me just before. And I was told, right, interview Richard Herring now. Oh, flipping heck. Mm. A joke that I tried to do on Ricky Gervais sort of backfired. The tone that I took was meant to be a joke, and because we knew each other, he took it as a joke, but the audience didn't know that we knew each other and didn't get the joke. And so I remember the next day walking through Edinburgh High Street and some kid went, you were really rude to Ricky Gervais last night. You're a complete and utter
Right.
And you know what my comeback was? Oh, shut up, you twit. Shouted at a child. And then at the end, it's like a live show. It's the Perrier Awards, right? And I was supposed to throw to Jenny Eclair, who was the co-host. I went, we're just going to find out. Towards the end of the show, last 6 minutes, OK, we're going to go to Jenny now, find out what's going on. Well, she weren't there. She'd gone. So they said, right, Iain, you've got 6 minutes, Phil.
What? Sorry.
I'd never done live TV before. And then then someone pushed Coogan up for an interview, who was, let's just say, very, very relaxed.
Right.
And he started talking. Perrier had just been bought by Nescafe, and he started talking about killing babies.
Oh, God.
I know, and I took the blame for it.
But the Perrier Awards is just like a show-off-a-thon, isn't it, anyway? So, and you get that many comedians in a room, it's going to be very, very bitter.
Edinburgh. And I was never part of the two times I did Edinburgh, I was always in the shadow of the people I was doing Edinburgh with. I always felt very left out. Edinburgh is a coke-a-thon, you know. It really is. It's powered by Bolivia. You know, it's a horrible... I don't know. I hate Edinburgh. I hate it. I like Edinburgh the city.
I've never been.
Oh, you'd love it.
Why?
Because of the drugs. No, just you'd love it because it's artsy and stuff. But if you go as a visitor, I've been as a visitor since and I've kind of enjoyed it more. But I always... last time I was there, I taught Christopher Biggins how to turn off his data roaming.
All right. Handy.
Very handy. There's Biggins.
He must have been paying a fortune.
Well, no, he was about to go abroad. Yeah. And I said, oh, don't forget to turn off your data roaming. I don't know how to do it! And so I had to tell him how to turn his data roaming off. But Edinburgh, the city itself is amazing. Mm-hmm. Go when there's not the blooming festival on.
I've never been to Scotland full stop, so yeah.
Wow.
I have to sort that out, haven't I?
You should sort that out.
Yeah.
You really should. 03459 455 555 is the telephone number. If you want to give us a call, you don't have to. Here's a thing. This is what's wrong with I'm a little bit windy. I always before the show.
I noticed there was a funny smell in it.
No, it's not. Oh, I had the dog the other day. I went to pick up the youngest from school. And I had the dog, and she was farting like nobody's business. And I had to say, really sorry, it's the dog.
Mm.
There's that joke, isn't there?
The dog's not in the room.
No. The joke about the boy goes round for a Sunday roast his new girlfriend for the first time, and he does a fart, and the dog's under the table. He does a fart, and the father-in-law to be goes, "Give me a dog's name. I can't think of a dog's name."
Shep.
And the bloke thinks, "Oh, brilliant! I got away with that." So he lets out another fart, and Shep. He thinks this is great. The dog's getting the blame for it. I'm desperately trying to work out how I can do the punchline without swearing. And so the third time he lets one rip and the bloke goes, "Shit, will you get out of there before he does a poo on your head?" that terrible, isn't it?
Wow.
Isn't it terrible? I mean, this show won't last long, so let's go and start.
That's a similar... I mean, that was a, there was a real-life thing with my mum when she was pregnant with me. Apparently, yeah. It made her very gaseous.
Really?
Yeah.
But what I do... Well, it does, doesn't it? You get indigestion.
And she was blaming it on the dog, and then they realised the dog wasn't in the room.
Oh, really? What's yeah. great about pregnant women is I don't find them sexy, right? A lot of people find pregnant women sexy.
I was told I was repulsive.
By your husband?
Yeah.
Well, that helps.
With the second one, yeah. And I was
second husband? Hang on a minute.
No, I've not met him yet.
The thing...
That kind of spoiled things a bit for me.
Well, you shouldn't have got pregnant. That spoiled it for him. I feel sorry for him.
I think that was his response.
There are some men who find pregnant women very sexy.
Yeah.
Because and I got a friend of mine, a guy I used to know years ago.
They're like a milky.
No. Oh, no, he said it's the glow. It's the glow what does it. And I was like, okay, it doesn't have any...
You're assuming all women have that. Not some of them feel rotten all the way through.
A lot of women look sick.
Yeah.
I remember, the thing that's nice about pregnant... Oh, we have a bell that must
you
be...
You rang?
Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Sorry, that's a poor recording of a bell this time. I no longer have the little
bell.
Oh,
did you give it back?
I managed to pass it on to my gran.
Good for you.
You now have to make do with a little clip.
I'm glad you thought ahead.
I did. Just before handing it over, I thought, oh, crumbs, how am I going to call up?
How are you going to let us know that you want to talk to us?
Well, this is it.
Go on, then.
This is it. Well, it's about Mr. Tony Blackburn.
Uh-oh, you're not about to out anybody. I mean, do I need to ride the fader? Are you going to say something libelous here?
I will not say anything.
You're not jumping on the bandwagon, are you?
No bandwagons in sight, just an empty Kinder Egg.
In that case, away you go, sir.
Okay. Thank you, madam. Mr. Blackburn, when he was... I've seen a clip on this TV show where basically he was stitched up like a kipper and he was singing to an audience of lions.
I saw that too. We talked about it with him the other day, didn't we?
I don't think it was on air. That was off air,
that conversation. It was all right in the 70s. That was what we were watching, wasn't it?
Yeah. And he was talking about it like, oh, you know, we didn't rehearse it and he thought he was going to leave the cage before starting to sing at them.
Well, that's not what he said to me off air.
Oh, good.
Because I said to him, did you get stitched up then? He went, no, of course I didn't. But he had no idea. The thing about the lion tamer having a massive load of stitches up his arm was absolutely true, apparently.
Blimey.
Yeah.
He's got nerves of steel if he went into that knowingly.
He used to do all sorts for him. What was he saying to us?
I wasn't really listening.
Parasending?
Parasending? Oh, yeah, parasending, and he was going over a motorway or something. And they said, pull it to the right a bit, Tony!
He said he used to do all sorts for that programme.
Parachuting.
What was it called? Seaside Special?
Yeah, I hope he had, like, elbow pads and things.
But, and yet I have turned down the offer of appearing on Channel 4's The Jump.
The Jump?
Have you not seen that? No one's seen The Jump. That's the thing.
I saw it just before I switched it over.
Well, who was in it when you watched it?
Amy Childs.
Is that Adrian Childs' daughter?
No. Amy Childs is from TOWIE.
Oh, it's that.
Darren Goff, the cricketer, was in it as well.
I don't know any of these people.
They were trying to invent some sort of romance between them, weren't they?
Turner was on it. Anthea Turner was on it.
Well, she'd be on
Who's
it.
Who's hosting it?
Amanda Byron, was it?
Right, well, it should be me. I should be hosting it.
Yeah,
you
exactly.
know what I think? I should be hosting it.
Hey, why not? Why not put that forward?
Because my TV star has sunk to such a low level that I only get offered the chance of being a contestant. They have a file of suckers. I said suckers. And you scroll down it to season 4 and it's me. It's my name. Don't pull the sad face. I've accepted it. And, you know,
I'm just wondering when it's going to be my turn. You're asking everyone.
The thing about TV is, right, I did miss it. I don't really miss it. I prefer radio, but TV's an half pay a hell of a lot better. I miss the TV money, not the TV work. It's hard work, and whereas here, we come in here, we rock up, and we kind of do what we want to do. On the TV, there's committees, and there's executives, and there's... Oh.
Yeah, but that would be the same if we were working for a different radio station, wouldn't it? If we're working for Radio 4, everything would be scripted.
Well, the stuff I just did for 4 Extra... I recorded some links for 4 Extra, which I think I'm looking at the date... goes out not next week, the week after. It's the comedy club section.
Yeah, but they were trying something crazy by letting you do that, weren't they?
Yeah. None of it was scripted. It's me. I mean, I told you, my boys are going to be on there doing their impressions of Frank Spencer.
And very good they are, too.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, exactly. I told the boys they're going to be on Radio 4 this morning, and that made breakfast an exciting moment. So whatever it was we were just saying, I wholeheartedly agree.
Yeah. Radio 4, sometimes it's not scripted.
Cheers, geeky girl!
Yes, cheers.
Oh, is that you? Hello.
Hello.
Didn't recognise her from without her avatar.
Without her avatar. There's someone else there. Who's that?
I'm Dr. Watts. I've just been called back.
What's going on?
What the hell is going on, Dr. Watts?
I don't know. I'm confused.
Well, hang on a second. I genuinely made a mistake, and that's absolutely fine. It's great to have you back. But
it's a pleasure to be back.
Did you not? You could have said, I've been on already.
He's polite.
Well, I didn't get a chance.
She's efficient. You're polite. She's efficient. It's Britain. It's Britain in the 21st century, and that's how these things go. The point I was going to make earlier on, Dr. Watts, and maybe the problem with this country, and we have to go to the travel in a second. The problem with this country is those contactless payment machines.
Tell me about it.
Go on, Wattsy. Tell me why you think they're a problem.
Well, first things first, you don't know if it was going to work or not.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's it! That's it!
And the machine's right? The machine's there, looking all pretentious. Oh, look at me, I'm contactless. And you say, is it contactless? No, it don't work.
Well, I don't even do that. I stand there for 10 seconds with the card touching it. Oh, no, sorry, it don't work. Well, what? The best. I went to a service station recently, Dr. Watts, and
they deliberately make you look like an idiot. That's what they do.
They'd stuck a sign on saying, contactless and does not work. Brilliant! Perfect. The whole service station was full of these little... what's that machine where it prints out on a little thin strip of plastic?
Like a ticker tape.
Yeah, what's the machine called, Watsy?
Oh, God knows.
Where you had to
spin the dial. Spin the wheel, yeah. My dad had one.
A dynamo.
That's it. A dynamo.
Oh, blimey, we're feeding back terribly, though.
Hang on a second. Whoever that is, stay there, because I've got to do this. They don't... I would say only 30% of the contactless machines are actually operational.
I've never attempted one in public.
And the thing is, right, you go and do it, and I've stopped. Today was the last one. Today when I was buying a coffee and some chocolate and a pasty, right, in a BP, and the last time I've touched it, and he said, no, it doesn't work. Right, fine. Well, I'm never doing
it
again.
It's over.
And whenever someone, some young buck, says to me, as I insert my card, I don't even do contactless, I tell you, why don't you contactless that?
Oh.
And I'm raising my middle finger. Because it annoys me. Who's that laughing? Who's there?
It's Julian.
Hello, Julian. Do you know what Julian. I mean, Julian? You stand there holding your card there like a plum. Oh, no, it don't work. Well, don't have a... if you've not activated contactless, don't have a contactless machine.
I'm giving you the come on.
It's ridiculous.
Exactly the same with my card as well.
I'm never doing it again. I'm always going to shove my card in the slot. Always, Julian. I'm going to do it. Because you're not going to make me look like a plum, guys. Just stood there for... It's like standing at a dead bus stop. A ghost bus stop, if you will. Which is only ghost bus to go to. Julian, what you got for us?
If I can remember it, a joke about a lion tamer.
Oh, blah, blah. Is it vulgar?
No, not at all.
Oh, well, never mind. Carry on. Go on.
I'll tame it down. Oh, I'll forget the pun. Oh, never mind. There's a young chap wishing to become a lion tamer. So he's in the cage with the lion tamer and obviously the apprentice there. So the lion tamer says to him, right, you hold the chair up, and if the lion's coming towards you, just give one crack of the whip.
Yeah.
So the lion coming towards him cracks the whip, and it still comes. So he says, right, and if you do it again, give it two cracks of the whip, it should stop. And the lion tamer says, or the apprentice says, well, what happens if it doesn't stop and you keep cracking the whip? He says, what you do is you turn round, you pick up a handful of poo and you rub it in the lion's face.
Okay.
And the apprentice said, what happens if there isn't any poo? And the tamer says, there will be
lion. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much indeed.
I know Julian's brothers.
Do you?
Yeah, I used to work with him.
Oh.
When I first came here, I was just a reporter.
And my story's seldom told. My name is Katherine Boyle, and I'm looking very, 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 very old.
Gosh, thanks.
Look at my eyes. I'm so tired. I stopped there. It could have been a whole lot worse. You got off lightly.
Gosh. Anyway,
it's a caricature.
In the olden days.
It's a verbal version of those people that sit in Leicester Square, proper busy, with those pads, and they have really bad drawings of Al Pacino.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
When did Al Pacino ever stop in Leicester Square to have his caricature done?
Anyway, so I was working at BBC Three Counties Radio under a different boss, not literally.
Although BBC back in those days.
And the boss approached me on a Thursday and said...
You were making love on a Friday.
I was doing the gardening programme on a Sunday, apparently.
That's
and
a euphemism.
I didn't know how to drive the desk. Oh. So I learned how to drive the desk in a day.
Wow.
In an hour.
All right, you tell that to James Whale, who still doesn't know how to drive the desk.
I think it's selective ignorance. He likes to have a minion.
Yeah.
Anyway, so I started doing the gardening programme, even though I had never gardened in my life.
No.
Thankfully, two brothers came along.
It's very trendy these days, gardening for ladies.
The brothers Hen.
Oh, yeah.
Julian's brothers. They were hilarious.
Professional
gardeners. Yeah, they used to do the gardening show with me, and they were brilliant. But it wasn't really about gardening, it was about what was messing about.
And that's there are still
you see a tendency there.
There are still people that want gardening. You used to have a gardening show. Why? Because you used to. Yeah, we used to. Now we don't.
But do you know what? The gardening show I did was the most popular it had ever been. Do you know why? It wasn't about gardening anymore. We just used to mess about.
Kath's front garden.
And my friend used to ring up occasionally and say they had problems with their spuds. That's what used to happen.
I'm glad you missed that innuendo.
No, I got it.
So, play a song that's going to make you cry.
No.
Gonna. It sounds a little bit... you might not. I've overhyped it. This bloke, I met this bloke years ago, right, when I was on Radio 4. A bloke called Fionn Regan, right? Mm. And I remember at the time thinking, this guy's amazing. And then a friend of mine directed his video. His video at the time was amazing. And then this popped up on Shuffle, and I went, well, not this song, another song. I went, oh, that's Fionn. He's good. I like him. I'm going to check out the album. I checked out the album, and then I remembered the, in inverted commas, hit from the album. It's pretentious.
So right on my alley.
It really is pretentious. I mean, he's referencing literature for crying out loud. Then there's it's a nice song, and then about 2 minutes into it, the harmonies come in, and I was driving my car, and it made me go, oh, have a listen to this. Oh, hang on, is this start from the beginning? Oh no, hang on. Here we go.
I apologize. I seem to have arrived home with items in my bag from your house. There's cutlery, a tablecloth, some Hennessy, and a book on presidents deceased. I'll have them FedEx to you. It was a strange thing to do. I hope we can still be friends. Oh, it was not me, but someone else you see, twisting the steering reins. Put a penny in the slot and make an artificial light shine. Leave go, my golden eye. I don't give advice, but be wise and think twice before getting involved in a game where the minority face the majority, who are faceless and born without name. Was it Knock Sink when we came across three men? They had church candles wrapped in newspaper. I bought two from them, and I lit one for you. I hope the message made its way down the wire. Put a penny in the slot and make an artificial light shine. Leave go, my golden eye. The soul of a dog, he's alive and not gone to the farm like the others said. A Rhodesian ridgeback off a beaten track in a furniture shop down on the quays. For the loneliness you foster, I suggest Paul Auster, a book called Timbuktu. Put a penny in the slot and watch the drunken sailor boy dance. She will not let you be her love. She goes out looking for the taxi. Her phone is ringing straight to message minder. Send out a battalion to find her. Put a penny in the slot and count the swans through a telescope. I can't help from crying. I wish you were mine. When I was 17, I followed my dream up into a high-rise block. The Adventures of Ogie March by Saul Bellow was all I had for company. At night time I'd lie in Beckenham Park with tears like flashbulbs, and recall my treasure searching days in the rock pools as a kid. To the remains of the Cheroplanes or around the bonfire in Naylor's Cove, good company and grief sit like a dock leaf sits beside a stinging nettle. Put a penny in the slot and make an artificial light shine. Leave gold, my golden arm.
Flipping heck.
Isn't it though? Isn't it? And what's great about it is for 2 minutes, 2.5 minutes, you think you're getting one thing, and then they just throw in 40 seconds of something else, and they never, and that's the best bit of the song, and they never refer to it again. Flip as Fionn Regan. Isn't that amazing?
Who?
You.
I am, yeah, I know.
Fionn Regan, honestly, that whole album, and this album, The End of History, is from like, I mean, when was I doing Loose Ends? That's probably about 6 years ago I met that lad. And he's
never
heard of it. Well, exactly. Doesn't mean it's no good, does it?
Oh, I don't think it was much good.
Well, you're a miserable old git, that's why.
Like that bloke, what's his name, Edwards, the singing postman.
Edwards, the singing postman. I'm thinking of Matt Munro, the singing milkman.
Can I request a song?
Who's this?
It's Nikki.
Yeah, OK, Nikki, well, say hello to Colin.
Hi,
hello,
Colin.
Nikki.
Hi, how are you?
Not too good, darling.
Oh, what's wrong?
Cold in the head.
Sorry?
Cold in the head.
Oh, right, cold in the head.
Yeah, well done.
It's that time of year, I think.
All week.
So. Oh, bless.
But I was just ringing up to say I remember the good old days when you used to do that show, Katherine.
Well, I was ringing up to request a song.
Were you? What song did you want?
Well, I wanted Shania Twain, You're Still the One.
Oh, sorry, I'm not into that.
Oh, you're not?
No.
Oh, that's a shame.
No. I'm not really into music.
It's the cold in the head.
I've had enough music this morning with Justin and...
You can never get enough music.
Oh, no, I'm not a music lover as such.
Oh.
You notice when they want a break, they always hitch two people up together.
I know.
They're good slacking, idea. Aren't they?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. I should go down there and give them what for.
Go on, do it. Might as well.
No, I ain't got the energy, unfortunately.
Oh, yeah, and I'm too busy, so I can't either.
I know it's only down the road, but they probably wouldn't let me in anyway. It took me half an hour to get in on the first show.
Oh, dear. That's not good.
No.
What's Iain doing?
I don't know. Not a lot, as usual. Spurting a load of...
Got his feet up, having a little rest, is he?
Morning, Nikki! No, hang on a second, let me try that again. Afternoon, Nikki!
Afternoon, Iain. How
hey,
you?
Nikki, you've got a special day on, haven't you?
I have.
Oh, Nikki, you're so fine, you're so fine, you blow my mind.
Hey, Nikki! Hey, Nikki! Hey, Nikki, you're so fine, you're so fine, you blow my mind. Hey, Nikki!
Oh, Nikki, what a pity you don't understand.
You take me by the arm when you take me by the hand.
Oh, the big Nikki, you can understand.
It's girls like you, Nikki! The what you do, Nikki, do, Nikki! The what you do, Nikki!
Yes.
Love it.
I had to stop singing there because I realised I have made up very, very rude words to the first verse of Hey Mickey.
Have you?
And I've been singing that for so long that I
can't remember the old ones.
Nikki, could you just stay there for a second? I'm going to sing the rude words to Katherine. I'm going to turn the phone off. Okay, so just stay there.
Okay.
You filthy beggar.
Isn't it filthy? I nearly sang that on BBC Three Counties Radio.
They wouldn't notice.
Nikki, what you got for us, my love? My love, what would you like, my love?
Oh, could I have Shania Twain, You're Still the One?
Well, it...
Right, hang on, tell us why.
I know we love it.
What's your musical memory that goes with this?
We don't normally do requests, but because it's the Saturday show, we don't really have rules. So you tell me a good story about it, and I'll see... we've got it on vinyl, actually. I saw it floating around on vinyl. Hang on, you tell us why, and I'll get it out.
Because me and my hubby Paul are renewing our vows today. And
you renewed your vows?
No, vows.
I didn't remove my vows.
You removed
We're
your
renewing our vows.
What, today?
Yeah, on my birthday.
Why, has he cheated on you?
Not at all, no. Oh,
you've cheated on him?
You're all clear. No, okay. I didn't.
Okay, well, okay.
Never would.
Okay, well, good. Okay. Well,
what did you just say? You had the 5-year all clear?
Yeah, and my birthday today. So
well, then, do you know what? It would be cruel of me not to play a request. We got it on vinyl, so it's going to sound fat and... Oh, there's echoey. Hang on.
Fat and juicy.
Fat and juicy. I need to...
be careful.
Can you introduce it then, Nikki, and we'll have it? We're not doing this for everyone.
OK, thank you so much.
Introduce it!
OK, Shania Twain, You're Still the One, and I love you, Paul.
This is for Nikki and for Paul. Cheers, Nikki!
Cheers.
Not a chance. Well, it sounds like... I don't know who that is. I remember the tune.
You know who that is. Donna Summer.
It's Stock Aitken and Waterman.
Of course it is.
Because it sounds like... you can sing it. Hang on a minute. Well, let's go into this. How are we doing it?
You can do all of them on it.
Here we go. You can put your faith in me. I would never set you free. Hold your head up high and let everybody see. With love to guide us, Edward can divide us.
I won't divide you.
Please don't divide me, Edward. Please, I'm begging. Although,
not again.
Part of me would quite like it, Edward. What you got for us, boss?
Not much. Can I play you a theme tune and you can see if you remember it?
Please do. I've got to say, everybody, including Nikki, who's apparently reaffirming her love for her husband, although... Paul, that's the fella. Everybody sounds miserable today.
It's the weather.
Oh, the weather's gorgeous. I love it. I tell you what was great, Edward, right? We're in Dunstable and there's a theatre next to us, right? And I turned up today. Normally the car park's empty. The car park was chock-up.
Peppa Pig's been on, haven't she?
Is it Peppa Pig?
Yeah, because they're coming out with Mr. Dinosaur balloons.
There were loads of kiddies coming out, like 3, 4, 5, 6-year-old kiddies coming out with their mums and dads. It was brilliant. And I saw the most amazing thing, right? I saw a 4-year-old kiddie, Wellington's, a mum... Wellington's. There's a massive puddle out there. They were both jumping about. They were puddling. They were both puddling about. Beautiful. And the mum wasn't going, oh, no, don't do that. They were both jumping in the puddle trying to outsplash each other. Wonderful.
We do that. That's why you got wellies.
It's what life is all about. I love going puddling with the boys. Anyway, Edward, go on.
Okay, here's the theme tune. You ready? Okay.
Yes, boss.
Braced.
All right, hang on. Wait.
Oh.
Here it goes.
Press play.
Oh. Okay, hang on,
is that part of it? Is this it? Is it?
Oh, no. Right, you might have to riff. Oh, yeah, here we go.
You have to riff.
No. Is that... Oh,
he's having a nightmare.
Right, I've jumped to the next video. I'm really sorry. here we go.
This is very muddy. It's hard to make out any tune, but I'm not getting anything. I have no idea.
Okay, I'm really sorry. That fell flat.
No, Edward, Edward. No.
Was it like watercolour challenge?
No. I'm going to say, we can work this out. It was tricky to hear, Edward, but I got some of it.
It was a Greek flavour.
It was Greek-y flavour. It wasn't, it sounded like 80s or 90s.
Yeah, early 90s.
Duty-free.
No, that went.
Poor Keith Barron. That posh woman, though, the other woman, she was, Angular Nose. That was her name, wasn't it? No, that was... I love an angular nose.
It's poor wife, poor Linda.
Okay. It was a sitcom?
No, not really. It was more a children's programme.
Oh.
Well, I wasn't really
ITV.
Watching kids' programme in the 90s.
On ITV?
Nightmare!
Yeah, no. Early. It's one of those 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock shows that are on during the summer holidays.
Flipping heck, mate. Chocky!
Advent. So I tell you...
Go on.
Right, I'll tell you who was in it. Right, there was a woman...
Edward, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Are you either on prescribed medication, or do you have your own little stash somewhere?
Okay, I'm sorry. It didn't work.
No, I'm enjoying it! Edward, honestly, I'm enjoying it. But you sound very, very, very laid-back, man.
Right, so I'll tell you who was in it. I'll tell you one name. Rebecca Elmer Loglu.
Oh,
that's Home and Away.
She was in Home and Away.
Yeah, well, before then, yeah, she was in a program called Adventures on Kythera, which is a kids' program in the school holidays in the 90s. Right.
You've literally made that up.
She had a very low hairline. Yeah, okay. I remember that about her.
She was pretty, but she had terrible skin, pockmarked face,
and her hair sort of began just where her eyebrows finished.
Very, very thick makeup on Home and Away because of the pockmarked skin. Well, Edward, I wouldn't say that fell flat. I'd say that was a wonderful success. It was a wonderful shambling mess, which is what this whole 2 hours is about. So
it's a beautiful show.
Bless you, buddy. You call up any time you want.
Thanks very much.
Thank
Iain,
you very much. Thank you.
Oh,
don't go away feeling bad because I enjoyed that.
I do, and I really enjoyed him saying Emma Loglu.
I mean, I wouldn't have a clue. Who from Neighbours and Home and Away has gone on to great success?
Natalie Imbruglia.
Where is she now?
Well, she was like the spokesmodel for L'Oreal for ages.
Hey, have you got tickets for the Natalie and Imbruglia concert? No, because she's not done a concert for 10 years.
I had her second album, right? It was quite good. No one bought it apart from me.
Oh, all she had was that one hit, Torn, which was a rip-off of another hit called Torn by a European singer.
Well, anyway, that was good, but there was a better one.
Okay, so we don't... She went out with David Schwimmer.
Yeah.
So she doesn't count.
Oh, I didn't realise that was the rule.
Well, no, but she's not a massive success. Jim Robinson.
Oh, yeah.
Because he's in everything. Lost, 24, the other programmes.
Ugly Betty. The Ugly Betty.
Okay, so we've got Jim from Neighbours, a bona fide success.
All right. Here's another one. The blonde kid from Home and Away, because he's in that filthy vampire programme, First Blood.
Oh, yeah. He's a bit... who was he in Home and Away? He's a bit goofy.
Mm. Yeah, but he's hot now. But
he was very plain, wasn't he?
Yeah, but now he's in a few things. I think he's been a copper in something as
well. I tell you who should have gone on to greater things and didn't. She was...
Guy Pearce?
Well, Guy Pearce, of course.
He wins. He's the top trump.
I mean, Guy Pearce is in every movie that's ever been made.
They have to pretend to be Americans, though, don't they?
The Carl Kennedy's daughter.
Oh, yeah.
Libby.
Libby Kennedy.
Oh, Libby. I think she was too busty for Hollywood.
Tell you, got very busty all of a sudden.
Pendulous.
Do you remember when Sally suddenly sprouted?
Yes, I do.
Wow, flipping heck. Sally grew up.
Who?
And out.
Anybody else that made it? Kylie, obviously.
Well, what about Sacha Baron Cohen's wife?
Oh, Isla Fisher. Yeah. Well, I mean, no.
She did. Then she married him and decided to have kids.
Yeah, she. She's a bit player.
Well,
really, and she's not. I wouldn't call her a Hollywood superstar.
All right, okay.
Well, that was a fun game. Shall we have our last song?
Mm-hmm.
Let's have something a little bit upbeat, shall we? Let's have the Bare Naked Ladies. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh no, I've got the wrong fader up. Ah, there it is. There it is.
I said goodbye. I said goodnight.
Thank you, Mikey Pavlou. We're going to be back next week, Monday to Friday, and probably not Saturday, you reckon, because there's football on.
I don't think we're on next Saturday, but right. I could be wrong.
But we're for Def's going to be here from 6 till 9 on a week.
Flipping.
What?
Why can't we just do this one gig a week? Because, I can wake up at about 10 o'clock in the morning for this.
Yeah,
still getting plenty of time. Don't forget, there's a podcast, the Best of the Weekly Show. You can go get that on iTunes. Type in Iain Lee. It pops up. If you want to listen to this on the iPlayer, you have to type in Iain Lee and Katherine Boyle. Should we go and get some Turkish?
I am starving.
Yes. See you later. Ta-ta. Bye-bye. Here comes the sports.